But it's not just that you and I believe that gender matters. There's a way in which gay people themselves believe that gender matters. And I want to pause on this point for you for a minute. In other words, if it's the case, if we're asking the question, who's going to be my sex partner? Well, gay people care whether they have a male sex partner or a female sex partner, right? They absolutely care. So if I'm a lesbian, let's say I'm a lesbian, and I'm looking for a sex partner, I really insist that it's a woman, right? I insist that I have a woman. Even a feminine man will not do, right? Even if I find a very feminine man, that is not going to do it. As a lesbian, I insist that my sex partner be of a particular gender, right? So what we're really saying here is that even people who have same-sex attraction believe that gender is relevant in the area that matters to them, namely sexual activity. They're not just doing a coin toss to figure out who their sex partner is going to be. They care. So what we're really saying here is that adults get to do what they want, and kids have to take whatever we give them. You know, that's where this thing is going when we look at it from that point of view. So our principal claim is really that kids need a mom and a dad. That two moms don't add up to a dad. And two dads don't add up to a mom. So it's quite possible that, you know, that two lesbians are each very lovely people. That there's nothing wrong with them. Okay, I'm prepared to believe that. Or the two guys are nice guys. But they don't add up to a parent of the other sex. And all of the research that's been done on how kids do in same-sex households don't really address that point and don't really deal with that point. I mentioned to you last week, those of you who are here, I mentioned to you that there's a lot of evidence about same-sex marriage, about same-sex parenting, and a lot of it's junk science. There's a lot of junk science, and sorting through the junk science and getting to the good stuff is a full-time job, and I don't do that job. I have a friend who does that job. That's Dr. Tracy Hansen, and I'll tell you about her later. But the point is that you don't need to sort through all that evidence to see that there's a sleight of hand being done here, and the sleight of hand is that somehow gender is irrelevant to the whole subject of parenting. So let's just talk a little bit about what we do know about gender and the significance of gender for parenting, because all of this evidence is off the table. See, when the same-sex activists start telling you, oh, research shows it's all okay, there's a whole body of stuff they never look at, and they never point out to you that this exists. So, for instance, we know that mother absence during infancy places a child at risk for attachment disorder, that the mother is very significant during infancy. And yes, you can have a substitute mother or a surrogate mother, but the mother's presence is very important during infancy. And we know that father absence during adolescence particularly is correlated with a whole variety of problems. And we don't know that it's just the father's being absent during adolescence. It could be the father being absent all the way along and the problems start to emerge in adolescence, okay? But we see that children in father-absent households have a particular set of problems that are not the same if the mom's gone, okay? The dad being gone creates a certain set of problems. Now, what are those problems? When the father is absent, the boys, teenage boys, are at risk for criminal behavior, for violence, for acting out, for delinquency, for going to jail. Boys are at risk for all of those kinds of things. And what is that tracking? What's going on there? Well, it's that the boys need a man to teach them how to be a man, to teach them what to do with all of that strength, and power, and energy, and enthusiasm, which is wonderful if it's channeled properly, but can be a real problem if it gets focused on gang activity or some other kind of father surrogate, which is what happens with boys who don't have a dad on board. What happens with the girls who have absent fathers? What happens with the girls is that they're at risk for early sexual activity. And all of the problems that are associated with early sexual activity. Now, which includes, of course, teen pregnancy and abortion and sexually transmitted diseases and multiple sex partners and all of the other problems that are associated with the early onset of sexual activity. By the way, even the Planned Parenthood people recognize that it'd be a good thing to delay the sexual onset. You know, that too much sex too early is not a good thing. Everybody, all across the debate on abstinence education and sex ed and all that stuff, everybody realizes that it's good to delay sexual debut. Well, so what's going on with these girls who don't have a dad? A couple of things are going on for them. One is, on their side, there is a longing for the attention of the man, of the male, and they don't have it from their daddy, so they're looking for somebody. And they're very vulnerable. They're very vulnerable to male attention because there's something missing that they're looking for. And then on the other side, I think it's safe to say that the predatory male senses the vulnerability of the fatherless girl. There's nobody there to protect her. There's nobody there. I mean, and the dads don't have to be standing around with baseball bats to protect their daughters. It's just the fact that he opens the door, you know, and he's there. And the sort of ambiance is that the dad is there. Now, there's another very interesting fact that's totally physiological that no one completely understands, but I have to tell you this, because this is one you can't possibly write this one off as culture, because it's just too physical and too weird. And it goes like this. It turns out that the age when a girl first gets her period is an important indicator for a whole bunch of stuff, including early sexual activity. If a girl gets her period earlier than her peers, she's at risk for early sexual activity and all the problems attached to that. No one knows exactly why that is, but that's true, and everybody knows that. That's not disputed whatsoever. It's also true that girls whose biological father is in the home with them get their periods later. Girls get their periods later if their daddy, if their bio daddy is in the home with them. Now, no one knows exactly why. And there are a bunch of theories out there about why, but nobody knows. Nobody knows for sure. And I'm not going to go through all the theories because it would take us too far afield. It's sort of pointless. The point is, nobody disputes that this is the fact. The fact is that the girls do get their periods later when their bio daddy is in the home with them. So what does that mean? It means that there's some kind of physiological connection that is created between the father and his daughter that is not going to be substituted. We don't know what will happen if there are if she's got two lesbians for parents. We don't know. You know, but we do know that there's something unique and special about her own biological father that's not cultural or social or something that we're going to somehow talk people out of, because it's operating at a much too deep level, right? You're not going to talk people out of something like that. So we claim, all of us, I think, agree that fathers and mothers are important to kids. The kids need a mom and a dad, and that gender is significant in the life of the child.